with great excitement and honor that I introduce our final keynote for FREC's 2015 Overcoming Racism Conference, Dr. Heather Hackman. Heather has been a contributing presence at FREC's Overcoming Racism Conference for at least the past 6 years. A former professor for 12 years at St. Cloud University, Dr. Hackman founded Hackman Consulting Group in 2005. She writes books, blogs, and newsletters. Heather has such an engaging way of speaking and living her passionate vigilance for overcoming racism at all levels, with all sizes and kinds of groups. Like all of us on our own journeys, Heather continues to expand and share her knowledge, her experience, her scholarliness, and her science. She consults on a broad spectrum of race and racism, including white privilege, how racism lives in our bodies, and the environment. Heather has many degrees and life experiences that you can read in your program from colleges and universities across the nation. She has served on the advisory board of the White Privilege Conference since 2012 and also advises other boards. Heather is a dynamic and powerful conference keynoter and presenter. We are so very pleased to welcome as our final keynote for this year's theme, Vigilance Now, Dr. Heather Hackman.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It is still morning. Awesome. All right. I had to take a look. So I just want to thank Gloria for the introduction. I've known Gloria for about 8 years now, and it's just an honor and a privilege to be your friend. It really is such a privilege, and I'm deeply grateful to be here. I want to thank FREC for the invitation, and to be honest, I was a bit hesitant because I've already spoken at this conference. I think it was about 6 years ago, and so I felt a little weird about doing it again. Nevertheless, I am really grateful to be invited and to have some time together with all of you this morning. So I'd like to start this session together the way I start all trainings and talks and you know, large groups of people. It can get a little interesting. And so I'm gonna start this session with a ground in. So
if you sit with your feet flat, you're able to do that.
I rarely get a chair where my feet hit the floor, to tell you the truth, so do whatever you gotta do. But the point of this first move is to just sink into your space. So if you're standing, just sink into your feet. If you're sitting, sink into that contact point, your feet, the back of your legs. And then sit as upright as you're comfortable and able to do. And it's important when we ground in before meetings, before classes, before trainings, before whatever you're doing, make sure we don't slide into this ableist framework of what grounding in looks like, what a normal body should be able to do, et cetera. So we're not trying to reinforce ableism in the process of getting us here. So we need to be careful about that. So sit as upright as you're comfortable and able, realizing that we all have very different bodies and it's gonna look and feel different for all of us. And then close your eyes or cast your gaze to a neutral site. Usually the back of the chair is fine. The goal here is no visual distractions. But I also want to acknowledge that it can be difficult for some folks, given so many things that have happened in our lives, to close our eyes in a public space. And so that's cool. If you can close your eyes, please do. If it's tricky or challenging, then just cast your gaze to that neutral site. And then begin to breathe as deeply as you are comfortable and able. Again, we have very different bodies, so this is gonna look and feel differently for all of us. So breathe as deeply as you are comfortable and able. And I'm gonna ask you to place your full field of attention on the felt sense, the physical sensation of air coming in and out of your nose, in and out of your nose. Don't tell a story about that. Don't tell yourself, I'm breathing now. Don't do that. Just pay attention to the physical sensation of air coming in and out. The inhale, tiny gap, exhale, tiny gap. Your mind will almost instantly begin to wander. Don't judge that. Don't get judgy about that. Just notice it. Just notice it and gently bring your full field of attention back to the physical sensation of air coming in and out of your nose. And we'll do this together for just 1 minute. Last exhale.
Salud. And in the spirit of connecting, please just introduce yourself quickly to the person next to you or someone around you. Just quick introductions. Let's come on back. So I want to talk for a moment about why we ground in.
What is the importance of grounding in when we have conversations about racial justice? What's the importance of grounding in when we have conversations about vigilance? And the first point here is that there's a connection, of course, between the body and the mind. And obviously it's the West who has decided to separate these things in the first place, right? These are not separate things. But the West has said, I think therefore I am. I'm just ahead, you know? And that's kind of, and white people are like, that's a great idea. I like that. Let's be heads. So white people are totally into that. And so what we need to recognize is that the mind and the body do have profound connections to each other, of course. And so why would we have all these stress-related illnesses if we don't have a connection between the mind and the body? But the body can also affect the mind. And so as we relax the body, as we ground the body in, we actually relax and ground the mind in as well. And that's important for racial justice conversations. It's important for the conversation I want to have today about why white people leave and how can we stay. It's important because we don't just need open minds around race. We need supple minds. An open mind implies that I will open my mind up and add some additional new thoughts to it, but it doesn't actually imply that I will uproot the old ideas I have. Do you see what I'm saying? And so there's no guarantee that an open mind is actually going to have me unearth the trope of race or the misunderstandings of racism or the ways that white privilege, white supremacy, and the white imperial gaze affect my life. There's no guarantee that an open mind will look at that, but a supple mind gives us a better chance of doing that. A supple, pliable, squishy, 3.5 pound, like that's what we're going for. That's what you want. And so we ground in because as I relax the body, it gives me a better chance of having a supple mind. We ground in because it interrupts the story. And so I don't know what happened for you, but you know, my mind goes, nose, breathe, ting, you know, and all of a sudden things are itching for you that were not itching 2 seconds ago. All of a sudden you're like, why am I doing this? And then you want to sneeze and you're like, I better not, it's so quiet in here, I can't sneeze, I'm not going to sneeze. And you're like, and you're having a horrible 60 seconds, it's a mess, right? And so we've got this chatter of a committee in our head, yammer, yammer, yammer. I've got 15 people up here. 10 of them are doing something else right now, you know, and so on and on and on. But as I begin to focus on what's called a physical anchor, I actually start to interrupt the chatter. I begin to build the muscle of interrupting the chatter in my head, and it's incredibly important because there is a 4-century tired old story about race in this country, and if I can build the muscle of interrupting my own chatter, I then have a better opportunity, a better chance, a greater likelihood of interrupting the chatter of the racial narrative as it shapes my actions, as it shapes our lives, as it kind of influences the way we interact with each other. I have a better chance of interrupting that story if I learn how to interrupt my own story. The third reason is that this is our place of action. We can learn from the past, we can plan for the future, but the only place I can act from is right now. Life is only available to me now. My place of power is now. You can get all little Eckhart Tolle, the power of now. Like, you can get all, do all of that. That's totally fine. But now is where it's at. Now is where it's at. And so if I'm not in this moment, my opportunity to be vigilant around racial justice, my chance to really pay attention to what's going on for me is diminished because I'm not even here. I'm not here. And the opposite is true as well. When we're not present, we make a lot of mistakes. We make a lot of mistakes. So It was a week and a half ago. Yes, it feels like a year ago. But a week and a half ago, I was training, doing a session in a conference here in the Twin Cities. And we were at tables. We were like half an hour had already gone by. A person walks in, and he tries to sit in the back all by himself. I said, I'd met him before. I said, Dave, why don't you come up and sit with us? And then he makes some kind of snarky, sexist comment. It was supposed to be a joke, but there was nothing joking about it, right? As he's coming to sit by a colleague of his, and that's the person that he made this funny joke about. And the whole room was like, whoa, man, that was not cool. What are you doing? That's not even funny. But Dave did that in part. I want to say Dave's probably a good guy, but he did it in part because he wasn't paying attention. He wasn't being mindful of the fact he walked in half an hour late. He wasn't being mindful of the ways his interactions were affecting other people. He was not paying attention. And because he wasn't here, something like that seems funny. But when I'm really present, I stand a greater chance of catching those things because before they come flying out of my mouth. So being here is my place of action. When I'm not here, I make a lot of mistakes. We also ground in because it speaks truth to our connection. And so the electromagnetic signature of my nervous system extends about 3 feet off my body. And, you know, lots of communities around the world have known this for a long time, but science has just discovered this. We've just discovered it. And I love the language of discovery. I'm a science geek. I went to the Science Museum with my friend Marie and her daughters a while back, and I just totally geeked out on the whole thing. I was like, I can stay here forever! You know, I had such a good time. So I'm a science geek, and yet I'm always disappointed when Western science says it's discovered something. And so our EM field extends 3 feet off our bodies. And so if you're sitting within 6 feet of someone, you're interacting with them. The technical term for that is you're picking up on their juju. That's what you're doing. That's the complicated description of that, is you're picking up on that. And so here's why this matters, because I work a lot with educators, and I have a lot of white liberal educators who what comes out of their mouth is a commitment to racial justice, but what's coming out of their body is not that. And so that student of color, something's gone down. I, as a white teacher, say, who did this? And I ask the student of color, did you do that? And the student of color says, no, I didn't do that. And I say, okay, with my words, but my entire deportment says, no, I think you did do that. But because I can't catch you, I'm not going to let this go any farther. Because I don't know for sure, I'm not going to say anything else. But I'm going to let you know I think you're lying. And so for, you know, year after year after year, day after day after day of that, for students of color, they know not to trust what white teachers say about, oh no, we're all one. We're all one family. We're the human family, right? They know not to trust that because what's coming out of me energetically is something that says, I think as an 8-year-old boy, you're a threat to this classroom as a young man of color. I'm not going to say it, but that's what I feel and think, and you're going to pick up on it. So we have to be attentive to the stuff that we're putting out there. We have to pay attention. And I'm not saying I'm great at that, but we have to pay attention. And the last piece is that it is a radical act to be embodied. It really is a radical act to be embodied. It's a pushback against systems of dominance and power and privilege. It's a pushback to say that the system controls, and it seeks to colonize our very selves, which is much of what I'm going to be talking about today. And so to say to super whitey in the dominant racial structure, I know you run this system, I know you run this society, I know you hold power here, but I'm drawing a line right here, and you cannot have me anymore. You cannot have me anymore. I am re-inhabiting, I'm reclaiming, I'm decolonizing my body, and you cannot have me, not for one more minute. Not for one more minute. That is a radical act. That is a radical act. And so I understand that this is not easy to do, to ground in and get in our bodies, but it's much of what I'll be talking about today and kind of the struggle of that, in particular for white people. And so there's a lot of reasons to ground in, and you just do it for a minute. I would talk to faculty sometimes in faculty development, and they're like, well, that takes a lot of time. I'm like, sister, if you don't have 60 seconds in your daily deal, you've got some hardcore time management problems. Like, that is, like, really serious. It's just 1 minute. It's just 1 minute. You only have to take 10 to describe it in that first class, and then the whole rest of the semester, everybody knows, just get quiet, grounded, get here, be here, be here now. Be here now. Be here now. But you may have noticed that this is a bit of an individualized thing. And we gotta try to move away from that individual act. And so we're gonna do something that's called a sound in. A sound in. It helps us move from the I to the we. The I to the we. So we did a ground in. Now we're gonna do a sound in. And I'm not sure how it will go with a group of this size, but we're gonna see. And so we'll do this because while change does require individual folks choosing to act, the change that we in this room seek can't happen without a connection to the we. Without collective, connected work. So for another 60 seconds, I'm gonna ask us as a whole group to sound. So you're gonna sing a note, you're gonna hum a tune, you're gonna share a call. You don't need to be able to carry a tune. you don't even need to sound good. This is not about judgment. It's simply about hearing each other in this space. It's about collectively contributing a sound, a harmony, a note to an ensemble that is much larger and stronger than we are by ourselves. So oppression thrives in isolation. Liberation lives and breathes in the collective. So let your sound, whatever it is, be from a place of love, of justice, of compassion, of heart, of we. And so even if your voice is trembling a little because you don't like to raise it too much, even if it's tight because you recoil from anything touchy-feely, even if you're overwhelmed, right? Like you could be totally overwhelmed by the desire to stay quiet because you fear that if you let just one sound out, your heart will absolutely burst and just might release it all. All those reservations are understood. They're all cool. No problem. Still, just give it a try. And we're only going to do it for a minute. And so I have a chime here. When you hear the chime, begin to bring it down. And here's how we'll start. We'll start with one deep breath, and as we exhale, we're just gonna sound in together, okay? And so in a, no particular sound, it doesn't matter. Just let liberation come out of your body, and we'll do it together, okay? So deep inhale, here we go. In and sound. Such beautiful, so beautiful, such a beautiful note. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank each other. Good job. Good job. That's good. So we ground in because we live in a society that makes it almost impossible to be fully present in the moment we're in. We sound in because systems of race, racism, and whiteness feed on isolation. Said another way, we ground in and sound in so we can be here together, in community, in relationship, in love, in life. We can be in all of this together. Together. But that is not always how it is it? Right? Too often, way too often, white people leave. We leave. It gets hard, it gets scary, and we leave. We leave this struggle, we leave these relationships, we leave these commitments. Too many times, white people leave. And that's what I want to talk about today with respect to the theme of vigilance. Why do white people leave? And to tell you the truth, I want to know why I leave. And more importantly, I want to know how we can stay. How can we stay? And I want to focus on this because I think that identifying or in identifying some of the deeper reasons that we as white people leave, we have a better chance of staying. We have a better chance of actually being vigilant in our racial justice work. The trick here is that I'm a multi-generational white USer, right, wanting to talk about whiteness at a conference about racial justice, and it runs the risk of making it all about white people again. All about, enough about me, what do you think about me? You know, me. And so I see that tension. I know that tension. I want to respect that tension. And so my hope is that this conversation doesn't serve to center whiteness and instead shines light on this question of why do white people leave? How can we stay? And offer some ideas for change. And I say this not because I think white people are more important. I say it because it's white people's lack of action and change that is holding this up. We are not achieving racial justice for lack of commitment of Native peoples and peoples of color. We are here. We are at where we're at. We're in this racialized moment in 2015 because white people have not woken up. I don't mean like learn something new. I'm talking about a real awakening. I'm talking about the kind of, wait, what's happening here? The kind of shift that makes us change our lives in deep and fundamental ways. That's what's required. That's what has yet to happen. And I'm wondering, why is that? Why is that? So I was supposed to be sharing the stage with another speaker, but because of a range of issues, I'm here by myself. And that's weird, right? Because if you look at the program, there's a lot of folks of color on panels and connected, but here I am as a white person, and I've got all this time to myself. And so I want to acknowledge that that was never the intention of the organizers, right? That is kind of how it ended up falling out. And while whiteness loves the fact that I am here all by myself, because like I said earlier, it's like me, enough about me. What do you think about me? You know, like that's whiteness. It's like whiteness, white, right? So while whiteness loves that, racial justice does not. So the committee members in my head that are tied to racial justice, they want to have a conversation of the heart, while the white ones want a lecture from the head. My racial justice committee members want to expose myself and whiteness in general in the service of being more honest and building more relationships and serving the greater good. The white ones are caught in facile notions of wanting to be liked, respected, seen as someone who understands this content. Whiteness wants me to stay safe with what I know, and racial justice says lean into what I do not. I have a feeling other white folks can perhaps relate to this. We want to open our hearts. We want to be more visible, but there is always something holding us back, and that something is what I want to talk about today. And the truth is I feel awkward about talking about, quote, why white people leave and how do we stay, because it's not a subject I feel incredibly well-versed in, nor is it something I can even trust my own perceptions about. I'm not sure I fully know why white people leave and how we can stay. And my doubt stems from the fact that after several years of doing this work, I'm still challenged by the temptations and traps of whiteness and its pull to isolate and to leave. Layer after layer, I wrestle with it daily. And if you're in my life, you know that to be true. And I'm still trying to figure it out. But here's what more so that I'm trying to figure it out. I'm still trying to understand the difference between doing racial justice work and living a racially just life. What does that mean? What does that mean? And so I can tell you that I'm good at the former. I deeply want and desire the latter. And the latter is a conversation of the heart. It's a conversation of the hard questions. And the hard question that I tend to grapple with is this. If I desperately want a society rooted in racial justice, why do I not always live like that? Why do I not always act like that? What is getting in the way? If I want that, why don't I live it to the extent and the degree and the consistency that I want to live it? And so in trying to answer this question for myself, I'm going to tell you just a little bit about how I got here, because it might shed some light for you on what gets in the way for me, and it might help us understand as a collective what gets in the way for all of us, regardless of our racial identities. So I was born in Michigan. That's me, 3 months. Look how pensive and contemplative I am at 3 months old. I'm already thinking hard about something. I don't know what it is, but I'm thinking hard about it. So I was born in Michigan, but sadly I grew up in Las Vegas, right? Not a city known for its exceptional social justice agenda. And to say that that's not on the banner. What happens in Vegas stays in Vegas, and we really care about racism. That's not what we do, right? And to say that I did not like Las Vegas would be an understatement, and as soon as I could leave there, I did. I did quite well in high school, and I looked really good on paper. I had great grades, AP classes, good SAT scores, blah, blah, blah. All in all, it was assumed I was a well-educated person who would go on to be successful in the world. What was on paper, however, belied my social reality. More specifically, I knew a lot about science, and I knew nothing about race. Majoring in biology and pre-med, I went to college in Los Angeles, a horrible place, LA, I don't know where LA went, there it is, LA, a horrible place to know nothing about race, and in no time at all, I was being confronted quite regularly on any number of absurd comments stemming from my substantial ignorance. In one particular moment, I was in a first-year seminar, and I was sitting at a table, it was kind of a long table, there was about 12 or 15 of us at that table. The professor was sitting over at the end. I don't remember his name, but he was a white dude, brown hair parted at the side, blue polo, thin yellow stripes. And we're sitting, I do remember that. And we're sitting in these rolly chairs, and I have no idea what we were talking about, but some comment came up, and I went, bleh, and I said some horrible racist thing, and the whole room got quiet. And my committee was busy doing something else, and they're like, wait, what's happening? And then, and so what happened was this moment of silence, and then my peers were like, what? And they just absolutely tore me apart, person after person. It was like racial justice tag team or something. It was like WWF racial justice. And so as soon as one was done, they tag and the other one, and you could faintly hear someone in the background saying, give her the chair, give her the chair. You know, like the whole WWF. And I was dying, I was blushing, I was embarrassed, I was mortified, right? And I look over to the professor, expecting him to help me, and he kind of rolls away from the table as if to say, feast on her, you know? And they did. They did. And so I was horribly embarrassed. I was absolutely mortified by that. And one would think that this horribly embarrassing moment would be sufficient to get me to change. But that is a misunderstanding of how deep my racist socialization went. You see, I was taught racism on some of the most basic levels that we can be taught. And so now I'll go back to this picture. This is me at 7-ish, 8-ish, somewhere in. I love that suit. I just loved it so much. I wore it all the time. So I was taught these messages at a really deep level. And right around this age, when I was 8-ish, I had a stepfather who was a pretty angry guy. And he had a hard time managing his anger. And as a result, he often took it out on my mother and me. I was the only child at the time. And one weekend day, I was in the carport with him, and he said a racist comment, joke, something like that. Not really understanding it, I nonetheless went along with it. And he praised me for that. And I couldn't get a kind word out of this guy. I could not get a kind word out of this man. But he praised me for that. And I did not know at the time what I was trading on in that interaction. But I did know that if I went along with what he said about people of color, his anger and rage at me abated somewhat. And I'm not saying I'm proud of this choice, but today I understand it. And what I understand is that my physical and emotional safety started to become tied, at least in part, to my participation in racism and my defense of and my loyalty to whiteness. My physical and emotional safety began to be tied to my participation. And I sometimes think if I could go back to her, who I am now, bit back in time, what would I say to her? And what I would say is, sweetheart, it'll be okay. You don't need to do that. You don't need to do that. But she didn't know that at that age. She did not know that. She was looking for a way to survive, and she found it in participating in racism. And so, in those same years, I watched my mother lock car doors in quote-unquote dangerous neighborhoods in the middle of the day. I saw my other family members talk about quote-unquote bad places to live, mostly POC native places. And I experienced other family members tell me I should not play with children of color because those people are a bad influence. Layer after layer, I was shown from every direction that the most moral, most honest, most safe, most laudable people were white. This did not land in my head. This is important. It didn't land in my head. It landed in my body. It landed in my spirit. None of these messages could possibly be countered by one embarrassing moment my first year in college because they weren't rooted in my mind. They were rooted in my body. They were rooted in my spirit. My physical safety and my moral well-being were tied to whiteness precisely because they were threatened, I was told, by blackness and brownness. Over time, without me knowing it, I began to feel that my very life depended on me going along with this system of racial oppression. And so, to quickly finish my story, because that's what I want to kind of get to, my sophomore year, so there's the stage I was first at, this kind of unconscious, conscious to unconscious racism. My sophomore year, I went into this stage of don't call me racist. And that was me showing up at campus events with no intention to change anything whatsoever. And so Desmond Tutu was speaking on campus. I showed up. I waved to everybody. I'm like, what's up, so good? You know, like, I wanted to be seen. I wanted everybody to see me there. But I had no intention of internal change. And that's what happens when white people make tokenized gestures. There's no intention for us to change our lives. We're just showing up and getting credit in some way for our work in this. From there, I went to this stage of saving people of color, native peoples, and it's horribly condescending, and it keeps the problem in this really individualized way. It essentializes the problem of race, racism, and whiteness in the bodies and the communities of native people and people of color, and totally ignores the fact that there's a system there. And I made mistake after mistake after mistake around this. I got confronted again and again and again, and that helped me move to the place of anti-racism, where I moved from the individual to the system. I could see the system. I could see what was going on. But I was just one bubble off plumb in anti-racism, which is why I don't do anti-racism work. I do racial justice work because I was just a little bit removed from that experience. Anti-racism implies that I'm going to end racism and try to help communities of color and Native communities, and it leaves me just a little bit away from me being in the problem. And so I would show up at events, I'd have the right signs, I had a sufficiently racial justice scowl on my face, like, ah, and racism. I had the right buttons, I had all the right stuff going on, and I would have Native people, people of color, and white folks who were farther, much farther along than I was, they would come up to me and they'd say, that's great, Heather, we're glad you're here. Why are you here, though? And I said, I'm here to end racism! And they're like, that's awesome, we really appreciate that, that's super. But why are you here? I'm here to end the system of racial oppression! And they're like, that's so great, that's almost what you said just a second ago. Why are you here? Why are you here? I want to know why you're here. I want to know what's in it for you. And what was hard for me is I did not understand that question. Not only did I not have an answer, I actually didn't understand what they meant. And what they meant was this, and this is the analogy I tend to give, is that white people stand safely on the shore, and we shout great tidings to Native people and people of color as they're rowing against the tide of racial oppression. And we'll hold up great signs and say, good job, I'm with you. I'll vote for that. I'll cheer for that. I'll send money in for that. Yes! Rah! And we say warnings. Look out for that buoy. Da-da-da-da-da. There's a big wave coming. Blah, blah. We'll even catapult food out to the boat. And you're like, blah, 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 blah. But nevertheless, the important point is I'm still standing safely on the shore. Like, my life has not been inconvenienced. It has not changed. Nothing about the privileges and opportunities I have changed. And so the difference between anti-racism and racial justice is we kick off our shoes, we swim out to the boat, we get in the boat, and we start to row alongside Native people and people of color. Row as if our lives depended on it, because in that moment we realize finally that they actually do. They actually do. And so the important, a couple caveats about this is as we get in the boat and we start to row as white people, don't name the boat after ourselves. Don't do that. Don't do that. That's a no-no. Don't get in the boat and stick a flag in and say, I've just discovered a boat. Don't do that either. Don't do that. It's so bad. And more recently with the Black Lives Matter movement, of course, don't start giving feedback to people of color and Native people about how to run the boat. Don't do that. Don't do that. With some grace and some humility and some commitment, let's just get in the boat and row, right? Just row. Just be part of. Just join this thing. Just join this movement in earnest, in earnest. So most white folks, including liberals and many who describe themselves as progressive, actually do want racial justice, and here's the catch, but only so long as it takes nothing away from us, so long as my life is undisturbed, so as long as you don't touch my stuff, and that, of course, is not racial justice. Racial justice, as I said, is about getting in the boat. It's about staying in the boat. It's about not only understanding white privilege, and much more about knowing what it means for me as a white person. Why am I in the boat? What does it mean for me? And so a lack of knowledge of how deep whiteness actually goes in me and in other white folks in this country is a huge, huge misstep. And it's responsible for so much of our lack of vigilance as white people. And so why do we leave? How do we stay? I want to take a moment to look at our bodies. I want to move to our bodies a little bit. So for colonization and oppression of any kind to stick, and in this case we're talking about the colonizing force of race, racism, and whiteness, it has to act on three levels: the mind, the body, the spirit. And I know, again, that the separation of these is a Western phenomenon, but I'm putting it up here not because it's true, but because it's the lens through which the West has enacted this colonial process. And in the conversations with some of the folks from the conference, while all of these three things are happening, I was asked to focus a little bit more on the body in this talk, and so that's what I'm going to do. Unfortunately, many racial justice advocates answer the question of why do white folks leave and how can we get them to stay with a focus on just one of these, the mind. The idea is that white folks are just miseducated, which is true, that's true. And if we educate them, we'll come around, which in part is true. And it's in part only because it's one part of three. But it's not the whole story, right? It can't possibly be the whole story. Because if colonization, if racism and racism and whiteness happens on three levels, then we have to decolonize on all three levels. Anything less is incomplete and will make it difficult for white folks to show up and stay. And so trying to address this, my colleague Susan Raffo and I spent 6 years designing, delivering, redesigning, redelivering, delivering again, redesigning, on and on and on, this workshop called More Than Skin Deep, and maybe some of you in the room have been in those sessions. And the purpose of this workshop was to explore why some of the best informed white people, I mean the ones who've read everything Tim Wise and Peggy McIntosh have ever written, you know? those white people, are some of the best white people can't fully show up when it gets hard. And instead of going to the head, Susan and I chose to look at the body. We considered things like the role of trauma in what keeps white people stuck. We dug into the ways that white people get triggered and let go of racial justice work or act in racist ways despite ourselves. And so we learned a lot in those sessions, and I think the participants did too. I don't know, it was very intense, as you can imagine. We learned a great deal in those sessions, but one of the interesting things that I took out of it, one of the most powerful things actually, was this idea. And it showed up in so many of those white folks' experiences in that workshop. And that's the idea that if people of color and native peoples gain real power in this country, it will surely lead to the annihilation of white people. Now, hear what I'm saying. I'm not talking about systems will change if that happens, or structures of racial oppression will change. I'm not saying that. What we saw coming out of the bodies of these white people, and to be honest, they were happy to be rid of it in so many ways, was this buried notion that racial justice and power to people of color meant their annihilation. Not change, not justice, annihilation. And it's not true, of course, but it proved to be a notion held in the bodies of so many of those white racial justice advocates that were in those sessions. And we know it was about the body because they were shocked to see it. And for many, it was this really kind of profound revelation, profound but not surprising, because the racialized system in this country could not have held on this long and in this way merely by miseducating white people. It had to find something deeper. It had to tap into something more primal. And so what it did, slowly but powerfully over 4 centuries, is trick our bodies into believing this annihilation myth. It tricked us. And the problem is white people don't have, unless we're in multiracial settings, we don't have a counter-racial narrative, the ways that Native peoples and so many communities of color have a counter-racial narrative, where the dominant society says, you're this thing, but their own communities say, yeah, that's a bunch of crap, we're not that thing. White people hear, you're this thing, and those people are that thing. We don't have any counter-narrative, so we say, okie dokie, and we just sign up for it. We're like, all right, got it. And so part of what we signed up for, again, as white people, is this belief that power that is held by Native people and people of color, again, is going to lead to our annihilation. It is a myth, but it's a powerful, powerful myth. And how did it get there? It got there because we brought race into our bodies. Race was not just a concept. It was something that leached into our souls. It got into our bodies, and we carry it out in our bodies. The story of race. The narrative of just race, not racism and whiteness even, just race. So let's practice something for a moment. If you'll get back into that ground-in position, if you will. And the people in the lobby who are eating and drinking, you got to stop for a minute. You got to stop for a second. They're like, what? You know, they just shoved a whole piece of pound cake in their mouth. They're like, oh no, what's going on? And so we're just going to kind of breathe for a second, and I want you to take just a minute to ponder this question, and I'll ask you to chat with your neighbor when we're done. So breathe, just take a couple deep breaths, if you will, just get there. And consider this, just for a minute even, where do you hold your race in your body? Where do you hold your race in your body? Last inhale, last exhale. Just for a couple minutes each, chat with your neighbor. Where do you hold your race in your body? Where do you hold that? So let's come back. Let's come back. So here's what Susan and I shared in that workshop. We talked a little bit again, as I said, about our bodies and paying attention to how race is in our bodies. And our bodies are amazing. And over their long evolution, they have carried with them a beautiful, basic response system to threats. We all know this as fight or flight, right? And I love the fact that that's actually out of order. But I'm not surprised that in the US we're like, fight, and then flight if you have to. You know, like, I'm not surprised that we're like, fight first, and then ask questions later. Right, that's kind of our deal, right? But in truth, this system has a few more parts. And if you're familiar with this, you're going to have to excuse me. You're going to have to excuse me as I give a really truncated version of this. But let's pretend I'm a gazelle. Let's pretend I'm a gazelle. And I'm kind of doing, I don't know what gazelles eat, but grass or whatever's going on there. I'm doing my thing. And I hear something. I hear something in the bushes. I'm like, huh? It's like a what, Scooby, kind of moment. Like, what's going on over there? And then it's just a nut that fell from the tree, and I'm like, oh, no big whoop. And so I go back to doing what I'm doing. But let's pretend it's a tiger. It's like, rah. And so my first instinct is to flee, not to fight. My first instinct is to leave. So really here, as I go through this, my first instinct when there seems to be a threat is to leave. That is my first instinct. And so I run, like, I'm just running, I'm doing super gazelle speeds, da-da-da-da-da. And then I get cornered. I'm like, oh, no. You know, I was saying to a friend, I'm a Scottish gazelle. Oh, crap, that's bad. I'm in a corner. Oh, jeez. You know, and so then my next move, of course, is to fight. And so I don't know if gazelles has horn, but let's pretend they do. And I start doing this and kicking and biting, and I do all my fight business. And I don't fight to beat up the lion. I fight to create a moment where I can again leave. My point is to leave. The goal is to leave. And so let's say I can't fight, oh, I'm overwhelmed. Then I go into this thing, freeze, which is, you could call it playing dead. So I just kind of play dead. But I'm not really dead. What I'm doing is I'm waiting for a moment to do what? Leave, 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 leave. And so the lion's about to do what it does. And then another lion's like, hey, can I have some of that? And he's like, no, get away, blah, blah. And so in that moment, I sense the lion's lack of attention, and I'm, phew, and I'm out of there. I leave. And if I can't do any of that, then the nervous system is giving me a really beautiful gift, and it shuts down so I don't actually feel myself being eaten by this lion. And so this is a really basic response, super helpful with lions, like incredibly helpful when there's lions around. Very useful, very useful. So what has happened with respect to race and white people in this country is that the system of racial oppression has essentially hijacked the survival responses of white people so as to make it seem as if people of color and native people, and even racial justice as a whole, is a threat to our very lives, just like that lion. White people have been socialized or tricked into having what feel like fight or flight responses to people of color, specifically to black and brown men. In this way, our racism and whiteness is not oppressive. They're just a natural response to an obvious threat. That's one reason why the notion of, quote, what a reasonable person should do, end quote, should never be admissible in court as a defense of a white person's racism. Racism does seem reasonable to white people because we have been taught to assign threat to people of color and native people. So if you ask what a reasonable person would do, a reasonable white person would engage in racism. That's how that system works. So how else could two different experts think that the murder of Tamir Rice was a reasonable response? How else could you get there? Logic has long since been left behind, right? It is clearly something else operating there. Because we know if it had been a white 12-year-old boy, that never would have happened. Again, this is not merely a cognitive reaction. It's a powerfully visceral response, and it operates so quickly and on such a base level that white people have a hard time even identifying it. For example, when a white woman is walking down the street and a black man approaches, to think that her crossing the street and her arm movement toward her bag is merely the result of her mind being corrupted by racial narratives, that is an incomplete read of that moment. What that woman is doing is responding to endless socialization that says he is a deep threat, and her body gets tricked into this flight-fight response. For centuries, people of color and native peoples have been presented as less than human and a threat to white civility, white society, and white humanity. And our white bodies have responded as if this was true. But that's an easy example, so let me give you a different one. This time, imagine a racial justice organizing meeting where people of color and Native people in the room are expressing pain and anger and frustration with the white people in the group for their lack of vigilance. Voices are raised, bodies are animated, confrontation is palpable. How many times have you seen white folks in these moments either get up to leave, fight back and defend themselves, or suggest that people of color and Native people should stop yelling, sit there quietly, hoping to not be called out so they can eventually leave without attention, or simply shut down and have no emotional response at all? These white people would not be in that group if they weren't interested and committed to racial justice, but something else is operating there that makes it difficult for them to stay strong and be vigilant. At the end of the meeting, many of them leave in shame because they know they should have engaged and they cannot understand why they didn't. Over time, these responses of white people lead to dissociation. In an interview with Krista Tippett, trauma researcher Bessel van der Kolk said that Western civilization is the most dissociated society in all of human history. And indeed, it has to be. How else could we have enacted such extraordinary violence and disruption around the world? How else could we have engaged in genocide and colonization and the institution of slavery? How else could we have done what we have done without being dissociated? Or in a smaller example, for a white family to go to church in the morning and a lynching in the afternoon requires dissociation. What follows then is making the dehumanizing nature of dissociation seem normal and even admirable. It's often called being rational, logical, or unencumbered by emotion. What would Spock do, right? But in truth, the lauding of the dismissal of so much of what makes us human is detrimental not just to ourselves, but it is deadly to Native people and people of color. The more rational, reasonable, stoic, and logical a white person is, the better a white person we are. For example, whiteness loves it when white people respond to people of color's pain by saying, "You're so angry, so emotional, so irrational." To be dismissive of what comes from the heart, what is revealed through the vulnerability of emotion, is a standard practice of being white. Over time, our white bodies begin to lose touch with our feelings and the capacity to respond with empathy, care, and kindness. The dissociation makes us hard and detached in the face of racial oppression and racialized violence. And this is an incredible cost to our humanity. In the end, we are isolated and alone. And that is one of the consequences of the bodily colonization of white people. We are lonely. We are lonely. Ironically, this leads to the final move that whiteness exacts on the bodies of white people, to simply detach from others altogether. In particular, rugged individualism is used to hide the profound loss of human connection to self and others. I love that phrase. "I was born in the log cabin I built with my own hands." Like, right? How is that even possible? How are you born in the place you built? I don't even know. I mean, if you have to think about it, like, yeah, how did that happen? And I love that phrase, not because I agree with it, but because it's the quintessential example of white bodies being individual, independent, alone. We are not connected, and therefore we are not at all bound to anyone else. Ultimately, your fate is your own, not mine. And so what does all this get us? For the system of racial oppression has an entire population of white people, to varying degrees, of course. We're not all exactly the same. But it has so many of us disconnected from ourselves, from each other, and from any of the physical markers that would tell us when something is truly wrong. And in its place, we're responding to physical markers that perceive a threat where there actually is none. So we're responding to stuff that doesn't really exist, and we're missing the things that do exist. In this way, our bodies serve as tools for the system of racial oppression. As Ta-Nehisi Coates in his book, Between the World and Me, and if you have not read this book, I strongly recommend you do read it, Between the World and Me. He described his body as not being his own. The truth for white people is that our bodies are ultimately not our own either. To be sure, we get extraordinary privilege as a result of being white, but the price that is paid for that is the capacity to be fully human. Jackie Battalora, in her book, The Birth of a White Nation, in the back, she's got some pictures of lynchings from the South. And so referring to those pictures of various scenes of lynching in the back of this book, the result of this price we pay, the result of whiteness, the result of dissociation, dehumanization, and disconnection is nothing short of barbaric. And it is our white legacy. And so what can we do? What can we do? How can we reclaim this? How can we reclaim this so that white people stay? Well, the good news is that there actually are ways to address this. There are ways to decolonize the body. Importantly, though, that does not mean learn more and do more. I just love white people in some ways, right? Because we learn about something and we're like, let's start a book club. And we're off with our book clubs. Get the book, have a book club. And as soon as we're done with the book club, we're going to be good with this. The other thing that I typically encounter in trainings is white people are like, what do I go do about this? You know, and they want to really do something. And so I've watched white activists and educators make the same mistake, right? They think that information and just taking action is enough. And they give these fiery talks with endless data and a sort of self-affirming cynicism about whiteness. But when I try to actually feel them at that conference or on that stage, I can't find them. They're angry, they're guarded, they're hiding behind the words and the intellect and the ability to write lots of books with pithy titles, but the heart and the emotion and the body seems to still be have them driving while under the influence of whiteness. And so over the years, I've come to not trust those white speakers for the same reason, to tell you the truth, that I do not always trust myself. If I cannot embody racial justice more fully each day, then it is right to wonder about my capacity to actually be in the boat. And so instead of book groups and doing something, what do we do? Well, the first step is to even realize that this has happened. Just realizing this has happened. Once we do, there are countless tools and modalities out there for getting in touch with one's physical self and re-inhabiting our bodies in ways that are tied to our beliefs in racial justice. Many of those body workers and healers are in this room with us today because I've seen you sitting here. Finding someone who can do the work of reconnection and body-centered healing, even if it's not explicitly about whiteness, is a powerful challenge to race, racism, and whiteness. And so whatever you can do tomorrow to inhabit your body more, to come home to yourself, to heal that separation, that in itself begins to push against race, racism, and whiteness. And I don't say this lightly because I know from personal experience how hard this is. It's uncomfortable. It's perhaps even scary. The body has memories. I was on the table with a body worker just last week, and she commented to me about what she was perceiving as an old and deep sadness that I carry. And for just a second, I could feel my pride and my ego say, no, I'm not sad, right? Because I was taught through the eyes of whiteness that emotions were weakness. And so to admit that was to admit defeat. Thankfully, right, I only felt that truly for just a few seconds and then was able to say, oh, super whitey, there you are. I see you, you know, like there you are, in me, not cognitively, but ushering, kind of pulling up this response of pride and ego and resistance and not wanting to be seen, right? And so I noticed it, and I got to notice it this time without giving into it. Because the truth is, I do carry a sadness. I carry a sadness about these issues, a sadness about what we're doing to the world and each other, a sadness about how often I fail to live up to my own deeply held values and beliefs. But I cannot have liberation without fully inhabiting this space, and that means being willing to take a look, to lean in, to approach this with an open heart. And so let me say again, I know this is not easy work for any of us. There are generations of stories written into and onto our skin. And yet, what other choice is there except to go into it? I've been told that the only way out is through, and so what would happen if we as white people laid down the guilt, laid down the shame, and replaced them with curiosity, grief, and humility? Be curious about what has happened here. Feel the grief and join in the calling and the deep feelings, and do so with humility, not with a sense of I now have all the answers, but with a sense of I really don't know what to do next. Can we do it together? And the answer, if we do it that way, is that our humanity returns, not all at once. But I tell you, everything that we have auctioned off to whiteness, we actually get back via the process of coming into our bodies and making amends. The integrity we lost by not speaking up, the compromising of our values for going along, all of it, over time and with work, starts to heal, and we reclaim our bodies. And this inevitably leads to a reconnection of the head and the body. We almost reassociate it, if you will. We reassociate, we get back into our bodies, which affords us the opportunity to plug back into our emotions, rehumanize ourselves.
And this can be completely overwhelming if you're used to being the Marlboro Man. Yeah, does anybody remember the Marlboro Man? Like, I'm a tough guy. That guy, never mind. So it can be completely overwhelming if you're used to being shut down, if you're used to being closed off, if you're used to being stoic. But I've had people in workshops who just instantly, at some point, they just burst into tears, these white people. And what's happening to them is they are feeling. It's like the sun coming out from the clouds after a long, long period of rain. And so from here, we can reconnect with others. White people and people of color in Native communities are separated for a reason. The connections that are made, the ways our bodies interact with each other, has this pesky habit of sabotaging colonization. When we laugh together, break bread together, share our lives with each other, when we fall in love, we are taking steps against the ways that bodies have been colonized. Now, please don't hear this as some sort of colorblind, apolitical notion that we can just date our way to racial justice, right? I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that. Nor am I saying the notion of, I have two black friends, is any kind of viable solution to racism either. What I'm talking about are real, deep, honest, and transparent relationships. The kind that have an effect on us at levels that cannot be seen but surely felt. I'm talking about the kind of connection that lifts the scales from the perspectives of white folks and allows us to perceive the truth of race in this country, which in turn allows us to truly be seen. And isn't that what we ultimately want? We want to be seen. We want to be understood, and we want to be cared for. And that, my friends, is the promise of reclaiming our bodies. And I implore you to lean in, to lean in. So just breathe for one moment together. I've got just a few minutes left, so let me share just a couple other thoughts, if I can. So why do we leave and how do we stay? There's a third element I haven't talked about, and you'll notice that I've spent most of the time on the body, right? And so again, when I was chatting with folks from the conference, they wanted some conversation about the body, and I wanted to honor that intention. And so I chose to spend most of the time on that. But before I close, let me say at least a few words about this third dimension of the spirit. Some things I've noticed with respect to colonizing the spirit is that this racially oppressive system seeks to crush any sense of hope for change, co-opt core values for the use of whiteness, and expunge the ethos of love from our daily lives. Through hopelessness, we often get tricked into collusion because it seems that this is an intractable system, and that's a lie, of course, but in a society that is often spiritually starved, it's a readily digestible lie. And when I do, I'm left hanging on to beliefs that can never really feed my soul. At the White Privilege Conference, Jamie Washington and I are hoping to be able to do a pre-conference institute, a day-long thing entitled Racial Justice as a Spiritual Imperative. And while using the term spiritual very broadly, we are hoping to have a conversation where we encourage racial justice activists and educators to unabashedly connect our hopeful selves to the promise of racial justice. And I'm excited for this session because in my work with communities of faith, I've seen exactly this process happen. White folks who are longtime members of those congregations approach others in the church and say that this racial justice work has enlivened their spiritual lives in ways they have not felt in a very long time. And that's because there is hope in racial justice. There is a sense of possibility, and there is a promise for a just tomorrow. And if we tie whatever you call spiritual selves, if we tie that to this racial justice endeavor, we drop a taproot into the ground that will bend but never, ever break. And I think the same is true for our beliefs and values in this society. Vigilance of the spirit means that we do not cede the moral ground to whiteness. We have the moral high ground here. We are on the right side of history, and I refuse to rock back on my heels and explain why racial justice is important and why it's one of my core values. Instead, I rock forward, and I ask, how is a lack of racial justice morally right? I make those advocating against racial justice in our society explain to me how racial oppression is viable. I'm not going to explain to you why justice is right. You need to explain to me why violence is right. And what I know is that to take this moral high ground and to keep it is to not let our values and beliefs be co-opted so easily and so consistently by a system that promises safety but delivers nothing but fear, division, and derision. And so white people, we've got to reclaim those values, reclaim them, not in the name of buttressing white privilege and white supremacy, but in the name of liberation.
And in the end, when I push back on this system, what is ultimately returned is my capacity to love. And I wanted to read an excerpt from Bell Hooks' book, All About Love, but you'll have to come to the workshop for that. And so I love Bell Hooks. I get all nervous around her. I want to say something smart and cool, and when I meet her, I'm like, hello. I mean, that's all I can say. It's never gone well. She must think like, oh, that's the one-word woman over there, because I'm like, hi, you know, like, hi. So I'll close with this. By this point, you are likely a bit overwhelmed. Someone nicknamed me in a training a while back, fire hose, and that's because I'm like, okay,
see ya,
you know, and I'm out of there. And so I get that. And you might be wondering, why on earth did they ask this woman to come speak? And I sometimes feel that way as well. But what's important to note is that I'm not talking about a static condition of this colonizing the mind, colonizing the body, and colonizing the spirit. I'm not raising these issues because they're something that can't be changed. On the contrary, I'm talking about this because it can be changed. But unless we acknowledge it or diagnose it, if you will, we won't see that change. It won't happen. And so I tend to think of this diagnosis as the full arsenal of whiteness and how it seeks to dominate the lives of white people and ensure that we will never be able to get in the boat. We will never have fully authentic and transparent lives with Native peoples and peoples of color, that we will never live racially just lives. And a diagnosis is just that, though. The greater question is, how will white people respond? More to the point, what will we do in these three areas to be vigilant and to stay? As I mentioned earlier, I would like to move from doing racial justice work to living a racially just life. And for me, that feels more like an invitation than an exhortation. It's an invitation to build the world that I think we all seek, a world that is healed and forgiven and bound together in love, that's deeply compassionate, a world that has made amends and sought to set right what has been wrong for so long. And you will hear people say that world is not possible. Do not believe them. Do not give in to that idea. That world is possible. I know it like I know. My heart absolutely knows that it's true. And as we walk this road, as we do this work together, we must remember that we have to stay together. You'll be told it's not possible. I've been told it's not possible. And today I know it's a lie. I believe with all my heart that we can find racial justice. Thank you.